Hi.
Hi.
So, my first question, it says on your Twitter that you're Jewish. Am I getting this right?
No.
Is it the right Twitter?
On my Twitter bio, it says I'm Jewish?
No, but like in your tweets. I don't want to be wrong.
I have Jewish background.
Okay.
Okay,
so as someone with a Jewish background.
Yes.
How do you feel about Bernie's plan for Israel, especially as someone concerned with foreign policy?
I love it. It's an absolutely necessary. My Jewish values teach me to oppose apartheid.
Okay. Could you elaborate, please?
I mean, there really isn't that much to elaborate on. I mean, has anybody ever been not only to Israel, but also to the, have you been to the West Bank? Have you been to Gaza?
Yeah.
You went to Gaza? Okay. But not to Gaza. Well, I know people have gone to Gaza. You could definitely go to Gaza. So for me, my politics are built on a base of, you know, economic justice and actually really like anti-racism, as in some ways as distinct from some of this sort of woke stuff in a way. But when I grew up, you know, I was pretty connected to left politics, so I always knew growing up about the travesty that was the human rights situation there. And I knew that people I admired, like Nelson Mandela, said, you know, South Africa is going to not be properly free until the Palestinians are free. In 2006, I believe, I read a piece by a guy named Tony Judt in the New York Review of Books, who was a really important Jewish scholar. And he just said, like, the argument was that, like, literally this is childish. Like, the idea that you have an ethno-state or a religious state, if you're committed to any type of broad-based social, economic equity and civil society, it doesn't work. No matter how justified, right? Of course there's justification because of Jewish history for Israel. There's justification for Kurdistan because of Kurdish reality. There's justification for Pakistan. It's notable that Israel and Pakistan are both disasters. Israel, not in the sense of, you know, look, if you're a European Jewish background, you have a nice life there. You're not. You are, even inside 67 borders, not a fully equal citizen. And the situation in the West Bank is, I mean, it is literally Jim Crow-like. And Gaza is, it's just an atrocity. So that's not something that anybody could reasonably ask me to support. And I understand, you know, yeah, there are some actions from some Palestinian groups that, you know, we can condemn. In fact, those have not even really been in any way seriously in play since like 2003. And when we talk about, you know, look, and the apartheid word specifically is both used by people who were crucial in ending apartheid in South Africa, like Desmond Tutu or Ronnie Kasrils, who served as intelligence minister under Mbeki, who I've interviewed. And the other main people who use the apartheid word are Ehud Olmert and Ehud Barak. So it is what it is. And I don't support second-class citizenship and occupation and sieges for anybody, no matter who they are.
Are you not concerned about the binary between either condemning Israel entirely, being like also a stance that a lot of like very strong and notorious anti-Semitic people agree with, versus like, you know, seeing this as more of a complex issue where it is wrong what's going on and that there's also a way to do this that Israel still exists and is supported?
So it's not a complex issue. That's the big thing. Super simple. There's one group that has enormous power. It's the most powerful country in the Middle East. It's backed by the United States. It acts on another population of people with total impunity and is never held accountable for anything. So there's no symmetry in the relationship, period. And just as like a thought experiment, IDW people, if we know that if somehow a population of Jewish refugees ended up in West Bank and Gaza, and an Arabic government in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv had an open-air prison in what, you know, Jewish Gaza, which they bombed with white phosphorus. They killed civilians indiscriminately, and they had no provisions for medicine. They had an embargo that blocked food, that the electricity wasn't running, that there was an over 48% unemployment rate, life expectancy and malnutrition statistics were horrifying. One of the major policymakers in this hypothetical Arabic Palestinian state said, we need to put those Jews on a diet. In the West Bank, there was another Jewish area where there was a little bit more autonomy, but there was regular Arabic settlements where they pulled up the Jewish farmers' foods, they terrorized them with rocks, the security forces broke children's bones, and they couldn't drive their own roads. We'd all have no problem understanding what that was. So there's nothing complex about it. The second part of your question, it's a pure asymmetry relationship. And the question is rights or not. So that's it, it's not complicated. The second part of your question, at this point, there's always gonna be crackpots who are anti-Semitic and condemn Israel. That's not what drives the movement, particularly in the United States. If you look around most people who are concerned with this issue, it's actually populated with a lot of Jewish people. The real question we have to ask is, why is it that AIPAC is hosting a information minister for Slobodan Milosevic? Why is it that there's relationships between the Israeli government and far-right parties in Europe? Why is it that Benjamin Netanyahu's son is posting borderline alt-right memes? Why is it that Israel is an alt-right state, even though it is from the descendants of the victims of one of the greatest crimes in history? That's a serious question, and that's inseparable from the racism of the project, which goes back to the first part that we have to solve. But thank you, shalom. And I am serious about it coming from Jewish values. Like Tony Judt, my reading, to the extent I do, which I actually do have some connection to that in a religious sense, it's unacceptable for me. But yeah, no, I know. But it's not complicated.